following program on Other Derana 24 is classified for general audience. It is intended for all ages. It contains little or no violence, no strong language, and little or no sexual dialogue or situations. The following program contains opinions of the participants and does not reflect the views and beliefs of the Derana Media Network. The network believes in a safe space for all ideas to be expressed without any censorship and on its duty to create such a platform for free speech. Viewer discretion is strictly advised.
A very good evening, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Get Real, where we talk to notable personalities here at home, abroad, anywhere in the world, in order to give you a different perspective with regard to the subject that they are entailed in. Tonight with me is the General Manager of the Ceylon Electricity Board, Mr. Rohan Seneviratne. Welcome to the program. Thank you very much for being here, sir. We all know, last year when we were going through the whole crisis in this country, the first shot was fired by to the country, to alert the country, saying that there is a crisis that has been brewing for quite some time, is when the lights went out. And then we got to know about the fact that there was no money to buy fuel to generate power, and that cascaded down into a lot of things, because if you don't have power, obviously people can't do anything. Our lifestyles are as such, no power, that means you're basically stagnated in that position. Yeah. Now, we went through a range of exercises which we did in order to address issues pertaining to the electricity sector. Have we come out of it right now? Because what people would like to know is, okay, it's not about having a problem, but have we addressed the problem and find real solutions so that we are not going to have this same crisis maybe this year, next year, whatever we will face, the time period we will face. So have we done what we are supposed to do?
Yes. Now let me briefly elaborate the situation in last year and situation today and situation for the future. So last year we had serious challenges of providing 24/7 power supply. I think you all can remember we started power shedding from the month of March, then it went to about 10 hours in April and so on. Then towards the end of the year, it was again about 2-3 hours and so on. So then we wanted to get rid of this scenario, mm-hmm. and to provide 24/7 power supply to the country. Actually, the reasons for 2022 power crisis are many, because it is related to financial crisis in the country as well, because country did not have adequate US dollars to import oil, import coal, and so many other things. CEB also did not have adequate money, because the tariff was not changed for a longer period of time. So we also did not have adequate money to buy certain equipments and things like that. So many problems, ecosystems cropped up. And because of that, this power curtailing went on for months and months. Then towards the end of the year, we seriously discussed about it and how to get rid of this and to give 24/7 power supply. Then we prepared a very good plan in November 2022, and decided how we should dispatch our power plants and how we should operate our other equipments to provide 24/7 power supply. So we were very well planned, and how the plants are being maintained, which locations and things like that. Then how we should buy coal, how we should buy fuel, the quantities, how much quantities for this year and so on, to provide 24/7 power supply. So in that particular plan, we incorporated everything and the plan was approved. And then the next big challenge was the money. Mm-hmm. So without money, we cannot do this exercise. So we convinced the higher authorities, everyone, we need a tariff increase. So we managed to convince, and ultimately Public Utilities Commission gave a tariff increase in February 15th. With that tariff increase, with our preparation and the readiness to provide 24/7 power supply, we started giving 24/7 from 15th.
So let me ask this question, sir. We remember that whole drama about the increase in power tariff and what happened with the PUCSL and all that. Yes. We don't have to keep going on to that. Yeah. But what I want to know is this. Yeah. Now, you said apparently CEB had a proper plan. You all came up with a plan in November of 2022. And that allowed us to generate 24/7 power and provide to the demand that exists at that moment. Mm. Now, did we do that prior to the crisis? Because, you know, what led to the crisis? Have y'all actually looked at it and find out, okay, these are the areas that we couldn't curtail, so we had to really fix it? Because right now, what I am understanding is that power existed, the generation of power existed even before the crisis, but apparently because of the fact that we couldn't put it into a proper plan or bring it into a proper system is the reason that we went for a crisis. So how do you respond to that?
No, not exactly. Our planning process was always happening. So we normally produce once in 2 years long-term least cost generation plan.
Did you know that the crisis was coming prior to 2022?
This crisis of 2022 mainly came because of the financial crisis in the ecosystems in the country. Nobody expected country to face a such large, severe financial crisis with fuel queues and many other things. No, so that impacted immensely for the power generation, because most of the things that we use for power generation are imported. Even the equipments, fuel, coal, power plant spare parts, new power plants, everything imported. So when you don't have money or the dollars to import something, then we can't import. Then we could not import coal properly. The CLPC did not give adequate fuel because CPC did not have dollars. Then we did not have rupees to pay for them because we did not have the proper tariff at that time. So these are different ecosystems. This is not really a planning issue. This is a country's economic problem also contributed immensely for this power shortage.
So then after the tariff increase, are we now on a settling path, or how are we right now? Because from February 2022, now you all have executed the plan. This is September. So what is the trend you are seeing right now?
Yeah, after execution of the new tariff, we were very comfortable of operation. We immediately got rid of the power cuts. So 15th of February, we declared the new tariff. 15th of February itself, we said no future power cuts. So since then, we are providing 24/7 power supply in the country. We are going to provide 24/7 in the future as well.
That's guaranteed.
That's guaranteed.
Okay. So let's talk about, with regard to, like, for us to understand, when you talk about power generation in Sri Lanka, we, in school books, we are told that we have all these power stations which generate through hydro. Then there are the other factors of, you know, wind power, solar power, those kinds of things also exist. But then are we predominantly coal generating country, power generated through coal? Or what is it? How is the breakdown?
Yeah, well, it is a mix of energy that we use to produce power. Different sources. Now, if you, for example, if you take last year 2022, we did generate about 30% of our requirement from coal. Then hydro also contributed about 30. Then wind contributed about 5. Solar contributed about 7. Then the oil-based power plants contributed about 17. So if you really look at last year's generation mix, we produced 52% of our electrical energy requirement from renewable sources. That's a very good achievement. So producing 52% of electrical energy requirement from renewable sources, it's a very good thing. If you compare with other countries in the region or all over the world, 52% is a very high figure. Even India, it is only 22% from renewable. If you take the world average of producing electrical energy from renewable sources is 26%. So we reached 52% last year, the previous year 50%. So our plan is to go for 70% by the year 2030. So that is the government policy.
Let's talk about those plans, because right now, like you said, the CEB has planned to such an extent to say that there is not going to be power cuts again, because you know how when you cut power, how it impacts the economy. It's like a recurring curse going around. But right now, the world is I think, miles and miles away when it comes to power generation. They're talking about a lot of other new ideas and factors. We have a problem right now with regard to our power generation, and also how much of people would be coming into the grid as we move on, the increase of households and things like that. So in a scenario like that, is the CEB taking adequate measures, or have they already taken them in order to move towards renewable energy and really look into sources which are not very much useful for here, mainly wind, solar, plus maybe nuclear energy, because a lot of countries do have that in Europe, in America. There are nuclear plants which is generating electricity. So are we ahead of the problem, thinking ahead and trying to fix it rather than, still going with this entire cycle of hydro and, coal power plant? Because I think that is something we, don't you think we have to phase it out slowly?
Yes, I think we are very well prepared for that, because the government of Sri Lanka, they declared the policy to go for 70% of electrical energy generation from renewables by 2030. So that policy CEB adopted. So all our planning, least cost long-term generation planning, way forward plans, renewable integration plans for 23, 26, 27, 30, transmission plan, all plans are aligned to reach this 70% scenario. 70% renewable is a very large amount, actually. When you compare world averages also, I said 26%. So going to 70% is a huge challenge. And we accepted that challenge. We prepared all our plans to go there. So in that context, we are going to change the energy mix. Now, I told the energy mix previously how we produced last year. But by the year 2030, we are not going to produce any electrical energy from oil. No diesel, no furnace oil. Instead of that, we are going to replace them with renewable energy plus natural gas. So natural gas will come to the equation. It should come as early as possible. So that
when you're planning on that?
So we are
natural gas to come into the
market. By at least by 2025,
okay,
it should come, natural gas. Because natural gas should remain for a longer period until we fully go for renewables. So by 2030, our energy mix, if you really analyze it, about 24% will come from solar. 15% will come from...
Do we have the capacity for that?
No, capacity we have to build. Now, as our plans, from 2023 to 2030, we have to build 5,500 megawatts of new renewable capacities. Those are mainly coming from solar and wind.
So where are you going to put these solar farms? Have you all thought about, land acquisition, getting all these kinds of things? I mean, it's nice to say here's the plan, but then when you try to put it into practice, you have problems.
Yes.
Like if you look at best example would be building the highway. The target was certain date, but then again, land issues were there, problems are there. Now we need to look for land masses in order to put these solar panels. Are we telling the people you have to, like every building needs to have their solar energy consumption, how they are doing it in America? If you look at the Apple headquarters, it's 100% renewable energy. That entire building is being maintained by themselves. So like that, what exactly is the plan? Because it's nice to say, sir, this is the plan, but practicality comes into play. So how are you addressing that?
Yeah, we are seriously addressing the plan. Plan is based on business models.
Okay.
So now, for example, to bring adequate quantities of solar, we have many business models. The first business model and the most successful business model is roof solar.
Okay.
The roof solar capacity in the country is now 731 megawatts. Our total day demand, including roof solar, is 2,700. So out of 2,700, 730 is coming from roof. It is not anywhere in the world.
So that means normal households.
Normal households, industries, and various households. So that is a very good business model. Every year, we are going to get 150 megawatts from roof. Last year, we got 150. This year, we are going to get 150 megawatts. So,
Those rooftop panels are massively expensive. Like if, let's say, a normal household to basically go and buy something, okay, I want to put solar energy into my roof, it's really expensive. The middle income class can't afford that. So why isn't the government looking at in giving it in a very, a nominal rate so that you would not be wasting money in implementing it, and people would buy because they went through a crisis last year and they don't want to go through that crisis again, and they understand if they have the power to basically generate it by themselves, they will definitely do it and give it back to the grid. So why not do that first?
Yeah, we are doing that. Actually, the issue is the roof solar panel prices, as you very correct said, doubled because of the devaluation of the rupee. The panel price when the dollar was 200 is almost double when the panel price dollar value is 320 and so on. So the investment on roof solar too increased because of the, all are imported. All panel and wires and whatever accessories, all are imported. So when the dollar devalued significantly, these prices go up. So that is one part of the story. At the same time, the tariff also increased. Tariff increased in February and reduced a little bit in July. So tariff also generally increased. Therefore, there is a win-win situation. When the tariff is increased, and if you are producing at your home, so you can compensate that. So business model is there. Because tariff also increased, panel cost also increased. So there is a business model. It remains. So there is so much of demand for roof solar. Every year, we are going adding 150 megawatts. That's a substantial amount of roof solar is coming. Perfect four business models are there. The net metering, net accounting, net plus, and net plus plus.
One of the things a lot of people were complaining about is the fact that, okay, I have a rooftop solar panel, and I have implemented it, and you know I'm utilizing it for my home use, but the CEB is so cumbersome in its process to add it to the grid. They take so long, so much of time, and there's so much of red tape. You have to keep calling. It's like I know this personal example. When they installed it in somewhere around in January, I think the CEB only came and got it to the grid somewhere around in August or July or August. So has that also been addressed?
Yes, it is perfectly addressed, because there had been certain things, certain delays almost a year ago, not now. We have done away with all the delays. The only thing is there can be a few cases here and there. If the customer has not got the proper approvals before he start the project. So you have to get the approval, because you have to do a lot of technical studies before connecting a roof solar to the national grid.
So it's not like I want to put roof solar, I'll just go to the...
No, you can't do that. You have to first get the consensus from the CEB. So we do testing, because otherwise it will go high voltage and burn equipment. So if somebody install without the permission of the CEB, then later on if he comes and asks CEB to connect, sometimes we can't connect, because when we do the testing, it failed. Then it will affect the other customers, and their TVs will burn. So there can be here and there small problems, but I can assure that more than 90% of the cases, see, we had done away all the connections. I personally look at it and see whether how many cases are waiting. All cleared now. Now it's going very smoothly.
Good to hear that right now, because energy consumption is a bigger issue here in Sri Lanka, and we don't want to do it in a manner where we are going to, you know, there is the nature concern as well. Now, you know, as conserving nature is something that, you know, people are getting concerned about as time moves on. Mr. Rohan Seneviratne, the General Manager of the CEB, is in conversation with me right here on Get Real. Let's take a short commercial break. We'll be back. I'm in conversation with Mr. Rohan Seneviratne, the General Manager of the Ceylon Electricity Board. We've been talking about issues that you are facing on a daily basis, and with regard to the power issue in this country, and also one of the things that is impacting every industry, not just homes, but, you know, the economy as well. Mr. Seneviratne, if you remember, there was a big conversation about this pricing. Because the amount that you're asking a normal household to pay for electricity consumption was quite high. With this economic crisis, a lot of people could not take that. It was a fact that a lot of people, so instead of consuming power, what they did was they switched off lights and just used it whenever that is required. So you would have seen in your monitoring systems that the consumption went a little bit lower during the time that you all increased, maybe from February to up until now. And we saw that you all actually brought the prices down recently in that tariff. What is the real formula that determines this? Because we see in the press, in media conferences, that you all come and say 150 things, but people don't get it. And mostly they are not concerned about that. But what is the biggest factor that is deciding the prices? Because is it the dollar? Is it the rupee? What is it? Because if you're telling that the coal buying for that we don't have dollars, or fuel buying we don't have dollars, should we be facing that out and go look for something that is, beneficial for the people so that they don't have to pay humongous amount of prices?
Well, this tariff setting is a very complex exercise. You have to do it very carefully. See, we do the tariff filing. Now, as per the government policy, we have to do it twice. For the first revision in the year is 1st January. Second revision in the year is 1st July. To do this...
Is that a new thing?
It's a new thing, new policy. New policy came from the government. Two times changes. So we are following that one. Then the tariff is prepared by CEB and filed with the Public Utilities Commission of Sri Lanka. They do all the analysis about our cost structures, expenditure and everything. So based on the allowed revenue principles of them and their tariff methodology, they give us a tariff. We can determine our tariff. Tariff is determined by the Public Utilities Commission of Sri Lanka.
Yeah, but you understand that entire conversation when the chairman of the former chairman of the PUCSL says, no, you can't charge that high, but then you all come back and say, no, we need this rate. What was the real factor there? Why were you asking for a higher price? And apparently the PUCSL former chairman was looking at, certain other data. So what was the...
Yeah, so data, the interpretation and the forecasting of data is there now. So we do forecasting because certain things you have to forecast, how much rainfall going to come, what would be the coal prices in the future, what would be the oil prices in the future, then what would be the demand for various months of the year, then what would be the oil prices, what would be the dollar exchange rate. So many things are impacted for the tariff. So when you look at our cost structure, 85% of the cost is for power generation. All the transmission, distribution, everything and the salaries and everything is only 15%. So the biggest cost comes from there. Then the impacts for generation cost are the price, coal prices, oil prices, exchange rate, how much of rainfall that we are going to get, how much of wind that we are going to get, and so on. So we have all the expertise to do all these calculations because we are at it. Every day we are doing it. We know how it happened for the last many years. We have all the statistics. So based on all these things, we made the filing. But somebody else can say, our filing is not accurate, our demand is not accurate. And they can assume that hydro generation will come largely this year, not what we have forecasted. So many things anybody can say. Then only thing is to really look at the cost structures. What happened was Public Utilities Commission did not agree with our forecast and various other norms that we use for this one. But now, after so many months gone, everyone knows that what we forecasted were exactly correct. So one example is the demand, the gross generation demand we forecasted in the beginning of the year as 45 per day in average. Now, the end of this year, we are going to reach almost same, or about 44.5. So our forecast were quite correct. Only forecast which was not that correct was the hydro generation. Because hydro generation, we forecasted 4,500 gigawatt hours from hydro generation. But all of a sudden...
This year,
this dry weather came. Nobody knew that. Even the weather department did not know that, this El Nino condition. Therefore, we are going through a dry spell so that...
But if you just go around, it's raining everywhere.
It's raining here, but not in the catchment areas that much.
And that's the next question that I want to ask now. Every single year, I think from days that I was small, looking at television news, we see that the big power generating power stations, when they get high amount of rain, the dams are full and then they are releasing water. And then the very next moment we hear, oh no, dry spell, no water. Now, what people are asking is, why can't you manage this excess water? Obviously there is, we know that Sri Lanka is going to get two seasons of rain. If we know that, if we know that there is a high amount of water, in other countries they do, they manage the excess water and then they put it into reserves and then utilize it later on in order to generate during the dry spell. We don't do that, we just let it go and we keep seeing it every day and in daily bulletins we hear that this amount of rain was there, that amount of rain was there and then the water was released and people always keep asking, well, in another few months you're going to say that we don't have water. So this argument of not having water and having water has always been a problem for people to understand why it's not being managed well. So what do you... No,
it is managed perfectly. So there are many institutions to manage it together, because this water doesn't belong only to Ceylon Electricity Board to power generation. Water is number one priority is drinking water. Number two is irrigation. Number three is power generation. So there's a water management secretariat. The Mahaveli Ministry, the Water Supply and Drainage Board, Ceylon Electricity Board, and many other officers every week sit and decide how much of water we should use for power generation. We have no control on that. The control comes from the drinking water and the irrigation. They are the top priorities. And based on that, when they allow certain amount of water to be used for power generation, we use that. Then we have the forecasting tools, how much rain going to come and so on. So based on all these tools and very special software, our system control center, very special software to manage the day ahead, tomorrow loads and how we should generate, what is the least cost options and how much rain is going to come. So it's a very complex computerized system. We use all the tools and manage the water perfectly. Because if not for that, we would have gone for power cuts long time ago in this year. So.
Why don't we... think of reserves, hydro reserves, in order to take the excess amount of water, we are instead of just releasing it into an area where we can hold it for a certain amount of time and then utilize it when we don't have water.
So actually we do that. We have reservoirs. We have large reservoirs like Kotmale, Victoria, Randenigal, and then Mausakale, and Castlereagh, and the Saman River. Those are big reservoirs. We can store big amount of water. We do store. We don't use what is coming. We store and use it for the whole year. So that is how we are doing. Then there is a runoff river, small power plants. For example, Kukule. If you take Kukule, a lot of rain comes, sometimes it spills because it's a runoff river. But all the big power plants, there's a huge storage. Storage amount is 1,200 gigawatt hours of energy. We can store in our reservoirs. We store and we don't use as such. We use with the permission of the secretariat and depending on the requirements, depending on the forecasting tools, depending on our software.
That reservoir is under your control or is it also, like you said,
no,
the irrigation?
The Victoria and the Kotmale and Randenigal reservoirs belong to Mahaveli Authority. Then Lakshapana...
Are they the decider of how
decide,
much?
They decide. They have the total ownership of the reservoirs are there. Then about Mausakale and Castlereagh, our ownership, but the water management secretariat has huge role there because it comes to drinking water in Colombo and so on. The only place where we own the full is Samaralaya Resort. All the other places, others are also there. So we as a team decide everything and we manage the water perfectly. There is no extra water release, anything. We store as much as possible, keeping for next year. Now, for example, now we store water. Now, even some rains come, we don't use because we have to have a good storage by the 1st of January to operate the power system next year, because next year also there is going to be a dry spell. So we store water now for the purpose of next year. So whatever the water that comes to the reservoir, we don't use.
If the natural elements like hydroelectricity is so volatile and so unpredictable, especially with the climate change and everything, you can't really predict the way you predicted prior. So in a situation like that, you earlier said that you all are looking at solar, you all are looking at wind. Is that it, or are you all looking at certain other new ventures that you all we can get into? Like, if you look at what Elon Musk is saying about, you know, stored battery-powered electric supply, he's talking about, you know, giving it to the whole of Dubai with a certain amount of generation. So, like that, are we thinking in novel methods, or is it this the same? Horses running.
We are thinking, Mahesh, we are doing that because when you look at the sources of power generation, the wind and solar intermittent. Solar can be today and tomorrow may not be. Wind can be today, tomorrow may not be. And 6 months of the year, wind is not there. Normally, only 6 months it is there. If you take the hydro, again, it depends on the rainfall and the weather patterns. It can go up and down. Therefore, to manage a power system, we have to have firm power. When you don't have solar and when you don't have wind, we can't introduce power cuts too.
Yeah.
We have to replenish that using other sources. That is why we have the other sources, like we use coal power, then we use the oil-based power. So oil-based power basically we use to bridge this gap.
But
only thing is, one more thing, one thing is oil power is very expensive. That is why we say we have to have natural gas. So we have to replace the oil power.
Are we still going to buy natural gas?
Yes, still going to buy natural gas.
Because there was the conversation, I think, a year and a half back, where we already have reserves in our vicinity in the Manar Basin, where we could have gone into it and actually looked into. But then again, that conversation just died with the entire economic crisis coming in. Are we at least looking into something like that? Because if we have that, then there is no issue in terms of, you know, generating power or generating any kind of energy into this country, and that would be a very good way of selling it to the rest of the world and solving our dollar issue as well. So are we looking into something like
that? Yeah, we are looking at actually under the Petroleum Ministry. So there's a special institution, Petroleum Resources Development Agency. So they are looking at it. They are looking at extracting oil and gas from Manar Basin. So those projects are still going on, but those projects are...
Is that a promising project?
It's a complex project, so it will take time and the implementation also...
But do we have the energy?
According to available information, they say there is a lot of quantity of oil and gas. But only thing is, too, having resources itself is not enough. You have to have business models.
Yeah.
Business models to use that, because if you get the gas in Manar, you have to have a pipeline to Colombo. To use it in Colombo power plants, because most of the large thermal power plants are in Colombo, because Colombo is the base load. A lot of load is in Colombo. So we have to have pipelines to do that. If you have, and also our energy requirement, electrical energy requirement is not that big. So if you have more gas coming, then we have to liquefy it and through the ships to export to some other countries. That's a huge complex process. More than $1 billion investments are required to liquefy. Liquefy and export through the ships to some other country. So these are complex arrangements, but it is going on. So we have to have proper business models, feasibilities, and go ahead.
Talking about business models, I think the minister himself said recently that we are looking at privatizing certain elements within the CEB because this government structure has not given the results required. But then again, that other side of the conversation is you're selling state assets and this and that. What exactly is your view on that? Because we understand it's not about just having an entity for the namesake and then it's not helping the people, then it's useless. You have to get it to work in an optimized manner so that people will benefit from it. In a situation like that, what do you think? Privatization is a solution into this, because that would bring in... the private sector's, ability to basically up the quality in comparison to government sector. So do you think that is a possibility, or what exactly is your view on that?
Well, government is working on it. So their first agenda is to restructure the power sector, and especially focusing on the Ceylon Electricity Board. So once it is restructured, so there will be many entities. Now there is only one Ceylon Electricity Board. So later on, after restructuring, there can be four entities for distribution, two entities for transmission, and about four entities.
Isn't that going to be very complex?
It's not that complex. It happened in all over the world. Many other countries also, transmission, distribution, then generation unbundled. And also transmission, you can have three, four entities to do the operations. Even now we are doing it.
Who's going to oversee all those?
So overseeing is actually the Public Utilities Commission will be there. There will be the regulator. So they will have to oversee the operations. In addition to that, ministry is there. Ministry of Power and Energy is there. So they also have to oversee. So there are many overseeing agencies. And also the overseeing should be done by each and every company. They will have individual board of directors and the chief executive officer. So they are responsible for that. Then that way, that is the first step. First step is to unbundle and to restructure so that to get more efficiencies and to get rid of the red tapes and so on, so that the efficient service can be given to the public and the customers. So the privatization, I don't know what's the government policy on that. But if you are going for privatization, it should be a strategic partnerships.
50-50.
Oh, any amount, but it has to be a very good partnerships with renowned people in the world.
Private sector coming into the field, do they have opportunities in the electric generation sector? Because I know you all buy power. There's this thing called buying power. So people are confused, where are you buying it from? Apparently, then we learn that there are little mini hydro power plants and mini plants all over the country. So that means there are people operating it in a private manner. Then you all say, no, when you are buying power from them, the cost is really going high and all that. Mm-hmm. Does the private sector actually have the opportunity to come into the power sector here? Because I think about a couple of years back, we heard a foreign company trying to come into one of our generation projects. Like that, is there opportunities for Sri Lankan businesses?
Actually, we opened the power generation to private sector decades ago. And we first opened for small projects like mini hydros, wind and so on. Small ones, maybe 10 megawatts, 1 megawatt. And at the same time, we opened for thermal power generation. Then the big private power plants came. Like, for example, West Coast is 300 megawatt private power plant. So likewise, we opened for thermal power generation and as well as for the renewable power generation. Now, in the renewable sector, now if you really look at the total generation capacity in the country, it is 4,800 megawatts, out of which 1,700 megawatts is coming from private sector. So this small power plants, of 350 small power plants are there, all privately owned. So they generate large quantities of energy using various resources.
So this argument saying that apparently we don't have the necessary means of generating the required power in the country is wrong. Is it? It exists at the moment.
It exists at the moment.
So then this conversation about we need to plug ourselves to India, try to look at, linking their power energy to us is because we don't have it here. So is that fault?
No, those are all business models. No, we have to see what is the best. We can have any number of power plants, but we have to see the economics of power generation. Our aim is to reduce the generation cost as much as possible and to incorporate as much as possible renewable energy. So in that context, we have to go for different business models. So India-Sri Lanka interconnection also on the card, it's a very win-win situation project. Very good for Sri Lanka, very good for India as well, because India has low-cost renewable energy, 24/7 renewable energy. So through a interconnection, we can buy power from India, and when we have excess, we can sell it to India as well. So this is a very good project. In fact, I led a team about a month ago to India with 9 engineers and had all the discussions. And now this is a reality, and this should be in operation in 2030.
So it's a reality.
It's a reality.
I mean, doesn't that bring in this whole question about national security, regional security, and the autonomy of this country, because if there is the ability for another nation, we are looking at what's happening in Europe right now, when Russia is basically controlling the energy power. Apparently, during the wartime, they shut it down, and Europe is now cold, and there's an energy crisis in Europe. So do you think it's a prudent decision to...
It's a prudent decision. We have looked into energy security. So we are not going to get large quantities from India. It is only 500 megawatts that we are talking. So in the energy mix, by 2030, it will be about 6%.
That 500 is going to go to the grid, or that will be bought when we don't have power?
No. It's connected. Both grids are connected. So if we have forecasted how we should use this interconnection, so our forecast is we may use maximum of 6% of the country's requirement from this particular link. So in case link is broken down, we can manage with our existing resources because it is limited. So those limitations will come with the technical aspects and the national security. So we have looked into all these things.
Good to know about that. Let's take a short commercial break. I'm in conversation with Mr. Rohan Seneviratne. He is the general manager of Ceylon Electricity Board. We've been talking about a lot of things with regard to CEB and getting a clarification from him. This is Get Real. We'll be right back. I'm in conversation with Mr. Rohan Seneviratne, the general manager of the Ceylon Electricity Board. Last year, as we spoke earlier, we had a crisis and electricity was a key factor in that crisis. You guaranteed saying there's not going to be any kind of crisis in the future with regard to power generation and power supply. Have you looked into all areas in terms of this? Because what I want to talk about is this nuclear energy concept coming in. There are lots of countries looking at. I think recently also there was an individual from the United States government coming into Sri Lanka in order to look at the possibility of nuclear energy being utilized for power consumption and power generation. Have we thought about things like that? Can Sri Lanka become a country? I mean, do we have the facility or do we have the capacity to build something like that?
Well, nuclear is being used for power generation in the world, all over the world. Many countries like France, in the USA, and Russia, so many countries use. If you take the world average, out of the world electrical energy requirement, 10% is produced from nuclear power. So what happened was, it has been there, and recently there were a few accidents. Because of the accidents, everyone thought that this is a really dangerous thing to produce power from nuclear energy. But now, with the targets for clean energy, because clean energy targets of the world cannot be matched only from renewable energy. Yeah. Because renewable energy has its own limitations. But nuclear energy is firm energy. You can get 24/7 for years of energy from nuclear. So now the world is looking nuclear differently. It is called new nuclear. Previously, nuclear was big ones. 1,000 megawatts, 2,000 megawatts. In fact, I happened to be in St. Petersburg recently, the Leningrad power plant of 6,000 megawatts. So those are big ones. But now technology is being developed to have small ones, like 500, like 250, even the floating ones. There are ships which can produce nuclear power. And ship can sail. Ship can come to a country and fix and provide the country from the nuclear. And the safety aspects, now it is being improved drastically so that safety is coming to a very high level. Because the reactors are different. The Chernobyl reactor and the reactors that they use in Russia now are completely different. New state-of-the-art reactors. So the failure rates and accidental rate is very much less. So all over the world, now going for small size, compact nuclear power plants. So we, Sri Lanka also, we have many authorities looking at the nuclear power. CEB also now joined with them to see the feasibilities, whether it should be added to our energy mix in time, but it takes longer period because consultation period is very long, maturity period is very long. We have to train our people, train our engineers, and get the public support. We don't have that at the moment, but it's a long consultation process. So those consultation process already started, so it will go for a longer period of time. At the correct time, if other countries of the world also going with this compact and the ship-mounted ones, perhaps Sri Lanka also can go because the technology is developing very fast. It's a clean energy.
Exactly. Right now with goals of getting into clean energy becoming important all around the world, I think it would be vital for Sri Lanka to think about it. And it's very happy. I mean, it's a happy thing to know that the fact that the country is looking into it in that manner. Right now, what are the other opportunities we have? Because in terms of like, can Sri Lanka become clean energy independent by a certain number of years, if you're basically going through your plan right now, or what exactly is the future look like?
Yeah, the government policy is to go for carbon zero by 2050. So that is a policy declared by the government. So if you are going for 2050 targets, we have to do a lot of things.
So one is oil, coal.
Yeah, we have to get rid of oil for power generation, definitely the oil, and then we have to take the natural gas as a gap fuel until we go for full renewables, and then renewable integration has to happen. So that should come with new technologies, smart grids, batteries, pump storage schemes, without which we can't integrate large quantities of renewable energy by keeping the grid stable. Grid stability is affected from the renewables unless you have proper mechanisms to manage it. Then you have to have smart grids, you have to have battery storage, you have to have pump storage, and so many other things. And the firm power also. When there is no solar or no wind, we should have other power plants which should run on natural gas so that we can use them for intermittency operations. So it's a complex plan. We have done that plan, and plan is done up to 2030 with a lot of details, and we are working on that and going ahead with that. But 2050 target is still more challenging because electricity is only 14% out of the total energy in the country in Sri Lanka. Even if we make 100% renewable from electricity, still 86% is outside electricity. So we have to convert the transport to electricity.
What do you mean by outside electricity?
Outside electricity, you take the transport.
Okay.
All oil-based. 36% of the energy in the country used for transport. So likewise, many other sectors are there. You have to convert those also to clean, because otherwise cleaning only electricity is only for small portions.
Finally, I wanted to ask, when you mentioned about batteries, it's actually a study done a couple of years back, which I read, especially during the crisis of last year, is the fact that apparently the CEB, I mean, if you look at your generating requirements during the daytime, you might not have a high demand. Maybe in the nighttime you have that. So during the daytime, if you have the ability to generate the same amount of power that you do during the nighttime, and then store it, have these facilities to store that energy, and then utilize that during the nighttime, you can actually have a better, periodical power generation, so it can supply and not just generate really high amount during the nighttime and then bring it down in the daytime. Have you all thought about storage, battery storage abilities in Sri Lanka, or is that already happening?
Battery storage we have already looked into and put it our plans from 2027 to 2030 renewable integration plan has large quantities of batteries, because what we are trying to do that era is to produce a lot of energy from, especially from solar. Then during daytime we have extra capacities. Then we have to store extra capacities in batteries and use in the appropriate time. So without the batteries, you can't go for 70% renewable scenario. That is one side of the storage. And secondly, when we have intermittency in solar, wind, and other even the hydro, when we have intermittency, you need backup power. So backup power during intermittency, we can take from the batteries. So battery all over the world, we are going for big scale batteries.
Yeah.
But the issue is we have to do it carefully. Batteries are still expensive. We have to put that cost to the business model and see where we are. Because our plan from 2023 to 2030 plan needs $1.5 billion for the battery storage. It's large amount of money is required for battery storage.
Have we not spoken to countries who are already doing that and to come as in a partnership for that?
Yeah, partnerships we look at for battery business models. Many business models are there to bring batteries. One is if we get assistance from ADB or foreign countries, fine. You go with them and take a loan and install your batteries.
That is
one thing. The second is the PPP model.
Yeah.
Private-public partnership model. We have really looked into it so that the investor will come and invest, and when he feeds our grid at the required time, we have to pay for that. So that is the viable business model. So we are working on the business models and trying to bring batteries as early as possible. It has to happen
It has to happen. I mean, so that means it's not happening at the moment right now.
For the moment, we don't have big batteries.
I mean, it's good to know that these kinds of things have been thought by the CEB, because power generation is actually very crucial, as we all know. Mr. Rohan Seneviratne, the General Manager of the CEB, thank you very much. It was a very educative discussion. I really appreciate you coming up and explaining all this, because these are vital information that our public needs to understand, and also retain that so that they might not get misled when issues do occur. Well, that's all the time we have for you tonight. Thank you very much for watching. I'll be back again on Sunday on State of the Nation. See you then. Bye.
Not enough just to call you a friend, and I know that I've done